Greg Shotwell, what would you like to see happen right now?
Well, you know, I think that we need to advocate for a national industrial policy that supports and sustains the expansion rather than the destruction of the middle class. And I would advocate for a policy that strengthens our economy, our national security, and makes the dream of a higher standard of living attainable for a wider number of citizens. You know, the working class is the backbone of this nation. And I think that we need to strengthen the American worker. I would like to see, first and foremost, that we have national health care, because this is the one solution that would help everyone. It would help the employers. It would help the employees. It would help the consumers. And that is the biggest factor that takes away our competitiveness. That's the one factor that would level the playing field, because all of our competitors have national health care and stronger pension systems in their country. And by pension, I mean government pension. So that when Toyota, you know, imports all these cars, they're not paying for health care. They're not paying for the pensions on those employees who are working overseas.
This is very interesting. Some people have called GM a healthcare company that makes cars, and that saying that they're building plants in Ontario because Canada has single-payer healthcare.
Yeah, this is the biggest advantage. They complain that they're paying $1,500 per car, and that cost includes all of the retirees. You know, they are one of the largest insurance companies in the United States. General Motors isn't just an automaker. You know, they're a real estate agent. They're a bank. You know, they're an insurance company. They have a piece on every square of the capitalist.
They pay more for health care than steel.
Yes, yes. And, you know, furthermore, we need, you know, these companies, and I think there is going to be a lot more pressure on this, but, you know, Congress acts like they had no responsibility. If Congress, see, we're the only country in the world that subsidizes outsourcing of our jobs. Other countries subsidize research and development, and they erect trade barriers to protect their basic industries. What we did was we do not subsidize research and development, and we subsidize outsourcing. Those are other things that need to be changed.
Shotwell, one of the things that you raise in some of the articles you've written is that there's a lot of attention placed on, again, labor costs, but that the actual production workers for the big three, their salaries represent about 10% of the cost of a car, while the money spent for supervisors and management represents 20% of the cost of a car, but we rarely get any attention on that aspect of the compensation.
No, that, you know, we all, the media and Congress really look at UAW wages, and this just shows their bias. But, you know, these facts I got from the book Fat and Mean by Frank Gordon. And he points out that the United States actually has, you know, like three or four times as many supervisors and monitors as Germany or Japan, that we waste a lot more money on management. But, you know, the actual labor costs, you know, this is another aspect I think that people don't understand. I understand why, but our productivity really should justify a raise. And why I say that, in 1992, you know, they say that they justify all this because we're losing market share. Well, the market has gotten bigger. The pie is bigger. But General Motors is selling as many cars. And the notion that people don't like GM cars belies the fact that they've sold more cars than Toyota. In 1992, GM had 34% of the U.S. market. This is from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And they produced 4.4 million cars. Now, at that time, GM's hourly employment was 265,000. In 2005, the market share had fallen to about 8%. But they had produced the same level of cars, 4.5 million, with 111,000 workers. With 154,000 workers less, they produced the same amount of cars. They lost market share, but they still produce the same number of cars. Their productivity has doubled. So this would this in normal times, when your productivity goes up, that means you deserve an annual improvement factor, a raise. We've got experience just the opposite. The only reason that auto workers make what seems to be a higher wage than non-union workers is that we have a cost of living adjustment. We won that back in 1970. But we often do not get any raise at all. And in the best years, we only get a 3% raise. But it's the cost of living that we have that is the difference between union and non-union.
Greg Shotwell, we want to thank you for being with us, union activist and co-founder of the website soldiersofsolidarity.com. He retired from General Motors last month after 30 years as the editor of the newsletter Live Bait and Ammo. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. We'll be back in a minute.